Good evening, everybody. I welcome you all to the lecture series on disability rights and the law. This is the third lecture in the series, which is being organized by the Center for Constitutional Rights, an initiative of Human Rights Law Network. And today we have Senior Advocate Jaina Kothari with us. Briefly about her, Jaina Kothari is a practicing advocate in the Karnataka High Court in Bangalore and Supreme Court since the last 16 years. Her area of expertise and interest includes public interest law, constitution, administrative law, social rights, disability rights, family law, consumer rights, and property law. She is also the founder of the Center of Law and Policy Research Bangalore, which was founded in the year 2009. Some of the landmark work that she has done includes constitutional challenge in the Supreme Court of India to the right of children to free and compulsory and primary education Act 2009, her litigation before the High Court on addressing out-of-school children and finding remedies to bring them back to the school, the case on National Federation for the Blind versus State of Karnataka, where more than 300 categories of government jobs were identified and reserved for persons with disabilities in the state of Karnataka, and a public interest litigation challenging the controversial Upper Bhadra irrigation project in Karnataka undertaken without forest and wildlife clearances. Jaina, we welcome you to today's lecture, and the issue that we are discussing today is employment opportunities and employment for persons with disabilities. And Jaina, thank you so much for agreeing to do this lecture for us, because we are doing some work on disability, and I think we have lawyers, law students, and persons with disabilities with us today. And I hope that all of us learn and understand a lot about the issue. Now, before we go on, just a small announcement. We have a live transcription and closed captioning going on. And at the end of the session, we will have a quick question answer round. And while some of the questions might come in English, some questions will come in Hindi. Now, live transcription or closed captioning is something that does not capture Hindi. So, if you are asking Hindi, then your live transcription cannot be transcribed in Hindi. So, you can speak a little slowly so that our interpreter can interpret for all participants. Shukriya, thank you so much. Jaina, I'll leave the floor to you.
Thank you. Thank you, Varsha, and thank you, Rajiv, for inviting me. And really thank you to the Center for Constitutional Rights for organizing this. I think it's a very, very important issue on employment rights and employment opportunities for persons with disabilities. And this really is the bulk of the litigation that is happening in the country today on rights of persons with disabilities. So I think it's really a good idea that you all organized a talk on this session, on this topic. And I'm happy to share my views and experiences on it. And I'm sure, members of the audience will also have their queries and their own challenges and other issues to share. Okay, so what I'll do is I'll maybe speak for about 20-30 minutes and then we could open it out for questions. Does that work?
Yes, absolutely, absolutely.
Yeah. Okay, good. So I'm really going to speak about employment rights under the Rights of Persons with Disabilities Act 2016. And look at issues of equality, equal opportunity, and discrimination within employment. When we talk about employment, there is both public employment and private sector employment. Though I will look at both, I'm going to first start with government employment and focus on that in a major way, because access and equal opportunity in public employment is actually one of the biggest problem areas. And there is a large, set of provisions under the Act, but there are many hurdles and challenges in really getting equal opportunity. So I'm going to really focus on government employment, though I will cover private sector employment as well. Okay. So now, how does the Act, that is the RPWD Act, address equal opportunity in employment? So, first of all, for public employment, the Act provides that there will be identification of posts which will be reserved as being identified as being suitable for persons with disabilities. And this will be done by constituting an expert committee. And then there will be reservation of posts. So there will be 4% of posts reserved for persons with disabilities in public employment. And the manner in which these posts are to be filled up is also given. So it says that, you know, even out of 4% of posts, it doesn't mean that all all these 4% of posts are reserved for all persons with disabilities. There is a certain hierarchy. So it says out of those 4%, 1% is for persons with blindness and low vision, 1% for persons who are deaf or hard of hearing, 1% for all kinds of locomotor disabilities, and then 1% for all the disabilities such as autism, intellectual disabilities, learning disabilities, mental illness, and multiple disabilities. So 1% for those. And then the Act talks about how the posts should be filled up. So first, for example, the first round when the posts are notified, they would be notified in this manner for, you know, this 4% in this hierarchy. And then if they are not filled up in that round, then they should be carried over for the next round of recruitment. So for example, if there is a post available, which is the first in line, that is for person with blindness and low vision. Now, how are all this, you know, this 4% where the first one is for blindness, low vision, second is for deaf and hard of hearing, like that, how are they managed? They are managed by a roster system. So in the government departments, in each post, there is a roster maintained. And the roster will give where the position of these particular reservations are there. So say, for example, in a particular post, say you have the post of headmaster of a school. The post, there is one post, and that post, the first option is for a person with blindness and low vision. And they don't find somebody with those requirements, qualifications, then the government cannot fill it up with either a person with a different disability or with a non-disabled person. The Act requires that this should be carried over to the next year. In the next year, again, it should be it should be called for the same disability, that is blindness or low vision. And if in the next year also you don't find somebody, then you can fill it up with a different disability. And in the year after that, you can fill it up with an interchangeable disability. And even if you don't find somebody with a different disability, only then after the second year, you can fill it up with a non-disabled person. So that much, that many measures are taken to ensure that the posts which are reserved for persons with disabilities and also specific disabilities are filled up by them and not released in the open selection, because then that would ensure, that would not give enough opportunity for specific disabilities and their access to government employment. Okay, that's about filling up. But what the Act also mandates is that in government employment, just reservation is not enough. There has to be non-discrimination. So the Act says there'll be no discrimination for persons on the ground of disability in employment, in government employment under Section 20. And how is this implemented? This is implemented by an obligation to provide reasonable accommodation. So there is a requirement and provision that reasonable accommodation must be provided. Now, what do we mean by reasonable accommodation? Now, all of you are totally, part of the disability rights movement. So I'm sure you all are very familiar with it. But I will just once again kind of talk about it. Reasonable accommodation, of course, is defined under the Act, but it basically means any adjustments, accommodations, or any special measures to be taken for any individual to ensure that they enjoy all the rights equally with others. So it could be any special measures required. For example, if a person is blind or low vision and that person needs reading software, then the employer, that is the government department, has to purchase that reading software so that he or she can work on the computer equally like others. For example, in a particular establishment, the sitting area of a person with locomotor disability is on a higher floor, then either there should be a lift or elevate or, you know, some access. And if there is no access and there is no lift, then that person should be given a sitting area on the ground floor so that that person is not then made, the office is not made inaccessible. So like that, whatever measures may be required, those are required to be given, and that is required to be given under reasonable accommodation. Then the Act mandates that there should be, promotions should not be denied, and reservations even in promotions needn't be denied. Now this is a very, very contentious area, and I will come to that later. And then the Act talks about posting and transfer policies. It says that the government must set up or frame appropriate policies for posting and transfer of employees with disabilities. Now, I would like to go into each of these issues. This is what the law provides, but is it being implemented? And so I'd like to go into each of these. So now, for example, the first one is identification and reservation of jobs. Now this, we know, many of us who've been working on issues of employment, we know that this has taken a lot of litigation and a lot of fights to get this done. Even under the old law and also now under the new Act, enough posts are not being identified as being suitable for persons with disabilities. And there have been a lot of challenges that have gone to different high courts. Finally, in one judgment, the Supreme Court held that, you know, where reservation was not provided in a particular post and the answer given by the government was that this is not identified, then the Supreme Court said, well, if you don't identify, then that's your fault. You have not identified. That doesn't mean that a person, a candidate is denied reservation. So even if identification is not done, the court has said that you have to provide reservation. So the government cannot hide behind their non-identification, which is what a lot of government authorities were doing. Then even when reservations were not being provided, even with a post being identified, in one judgment in the case of National Federation of the Blind, the Supreme Court said that all the reservations must be done. They should be filled up across the board. And also, what do vacancies mean? They are in the cadre or in the number of posts. All that was clarified. And the authorities were asked to fill up all the vacancies. Now, we are seeing that in many states, backlog vacancies are not filled up. I mean, I can just give my example of Karnataka. You know, in Karnataka, we had from, if you take the 1996 Act, the 95 Act, sorry, we provided 3% reservation, and now the 2016 Act. None of the backlog is, you know, there are so many actually backlog posts that should have been given, which have not been given. And this is an issue which has been taken up, I think, in the Bombay High Court as well and in some other high courts as well. So identification and reservation of posts is not being done, and there are many backlog vacancies. Then the second issue that comes up is, even where identification is being done, it's not being done properly. I mean, in the sense, it's being done in a manner which is discriminatory to persons with disabilities. Now, Let me give you an example. One of the posts that is constantly being denied to persons with disabilities are the posts of judges. Now, civil judges posts. Now, it's a very prestigious post, especially district court judges or civil judges or junior civil judges. Now, routinely, we are seeing that in many different states, while they allow reservation for persons with locomotor disabilities, persons with visual blindness, low vision, or hearing impairment are being excluded. Now, this went up to the Supreme Court and from Tamil Nadu. And when this went up to the Supreme Court dismissed it. But in a recent decision of Vikash Kumar, the Supreme Court went back to refer to this judgment and said that reasonable accommodation would require that we don't say that a person with blindness or hearing impairment is incapable or not able to do a job of a judge, but we provide the reasonable accommodation needed. So what does that person need to do his or her job as a judge? And that should be provided, and that judgment in the Tamil Nadu case would not hold good. Now, we are in Karnataka fighting for reservation of civil judges, which has been denied. In Bombay, in Maharashtra, there is an advocate who is blind and who's fighting for it. So, you know, these battles are still on. And though identification and reservation is there, we are seeing a very, a discriminatory mindset where some kinds of jobs are seen as being capable of being done. But, you know, the minute you have jobs like judges, the general perception is that persons with disabilities cannot do it. And so there we need to question it. So to ensure that all jobs are open and with reasonable accommodation, they are made, accessible and, identified for persons with disabilities. And then this brings us to the issue of reasonable accommodation. So when we talk about reasonable accommodation for posts, we also need reasonable accommodation in the entire process leading to the selection. So, for example, there have been a lot of battles on, exams and, writing the exams, especially if they're by public service commissions. So additional time, provision of scribes. So all those provisions also where special measures are taken for persons with disabilities also come under the ambit of reasonable accommodation. I'll just take a minute. So, for example, one recent judgment was that of Vikash Kumar, which I just mentioned earlier, where the person who was applying for the UPSC exam was a person with a certain disability called writer's cramp, and he did not come under the definition of benchmark disability. And so under the RPWD Act, since reservation is provided only for persons with benchmark disability, which is 40% of the specified disability, he was not allowed the facility of a scribe. And the UPSC said, well, he's not entitled to reservation. The court said, well, he may or may not be entitled to reservation, but he has a disability. It may not be a benchmark disability. But you have to provide reasonable accommodation and you have to therefore provide the scribe in this case. Because he has writer's cramp, which is a writing related disability. He could not write the paper, so he needed a scribe. And therefore the court, in fact, went into a whole, elaboration of how reasonable accommodation is a very important part of equality and that has to be provided. Now, in fact, this is an issue in the current UPSC IAS exams. I've got a lot of queries because in that judgment, the court in fact said that there should be a circular notification issued that even without benchmark disability, everyone would get facilities of a scribe. But still the UPSC has not done that, and now there are people with similar situations who are unable to get a scribe. And so the Vikash Kumar judgment was extremely, extremely important. In many other cases, reasonable accommodation has been interpreted to mean giving relaxation in eligibility conditions. So, for example, we had a case in Karnataka High Court where it was a very interesting case where this person with low vision had applied for a position at a central government institution, and there were certain eligibility conditions which were put. Now, the eligibility conditions were educational qualifications, which this person had, whatever degree, MBA, etc., this person had it. And then the other condition was that you should have 8 years' experience in a government institution. Now, we know how difficult it is to get a government job, right, for a person with disability. Now, he had 8 years' experience, but in private sector, because it is so difficult to get a government job. So he was rejected, and there was no other person in that reserved post of low vision and blindness who had the 8 years experience in government job. See, it is like chicken and egg. You want a government job, but you don't get it. And then the eligibility for the government job is you should have 8 years government experience. So we challenged his rejection, and we went to court, and we asked the court that you give me reasonable accommodation, you adjust my qualification, you give me some concession in the qualification. And there is actually a central government official memorandum which says that if there is no other person with disability who is qualified, then the institution or the authorities can change the eligibility conditions, alter it to give the person a chance if nobody else is there. So we said reasonable accommodation means you give some alteration. You consider private sector employment as experience, right? If I never get an entry into the government, how will I get government experience? And the court has in fact passed a favorable order and asking that government institution to consider and to provide him the job. So reasonable accommodation also means that modifying some eligibility requirements if it is too hard for anybody to fulfill. Okay. Then I'll go into the issue of promotions. Now, reservations in promotions are also a huge area of, contention. Now, under the old Act, the 95 Act, it just talks about reservations. And 3% reservations of posts were there. Then the question came of promotions. Now, in the government sector, there are many posts which many of you, if you're working in the government or familiar with it, will know. There are many top posts where you can't enter directly. You can only get through promotions through the internal route. So these are posts only through promotion. Now, what the government was doing is that it was not giving any reservations in promotions. So the person with disability will get the direct recruitment reservation, you'll come up and then you'll stop. You can never go to the top because you don't have reservations, and only if in the general category you can go to the top. But we know how difficult that is. So what the central government had done is that only in the lowest posts, in group C and D category of posts, they were allowing reservations and promotions. But in group A and B, they were not allowing. That means you'll never get to the top in your department. So we challenged this in the Supreme Court. It went up all the way to the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court gave a very, very positive judgment saying there has to be reservations and promotions also, because the law talks about reservations. It doesn't distinguish between initial recruitment, promotions, or whatever. Now, under the RPWD Act, there is a provision which says that the government may make certain notifications for reservations and promotions. Now, the Supreme Court has asked the government, why haven't you done it? And the government has been given 4 months' time to make this. Now, unfortunately, in this litigation, the actual petitioner who had filed it, Dr. Siddharaju, he has still not been given his promotion. So from 7 years, we are fighting it. And though we have got a very good judgment, we have filed a contempt petition, and his relief is still pending. Then the next issue become I would like to address is transfers. Now, this is also there in the Act. Now, many people with disabilities, they once they get the reservation, they get employment, then the issue of transfers comes into play. Because in government jobs, you know that after initial 3-4 years of posting, there are regular transfers. Now, transfers become very difficult because supposing the person has family support in his or her place of work, and then you're sent somewhere else, then how will, depending on your disability, how will you, will whether your family member can come with you or not? Then if they can't come with you, then how will you manage? Supposing you have, you know, how do you get familiar and access, you know, with accessibility and all those issues? So many of those issues come into play. And then transfers become another problem where often persons with disabilities find that they are not permitted to retain or be in the same place and oppose the transfer. Now, the Act says that the government should frame policies for transfer, but this is not being done yet. So these transfer policies also, you know, to give some concession to say that if a person with disability does not want to be transferred, then some concessions can be given. None of those policies are made. So that is again an area of implementation. So, you know, whether relaxation of transfers can be given or some choice in transfers, it is all at the discretion of the government. And often we find that that is actually used to harass people with disabilities and harass employees with disabilities. Okay, so now these are all the issues when it comes to government employment. What is the law relating to private employment? Now, under the RPD Act, unfortunately, there is not much coverage of private employment and access to persons with disabilities. There's a general provision that there'll be no discrimination against persons with disabilities and they'll be treated equally. there is a requirement that every employer should have an equal opportunity policy in place in their employment, and there should be a grievance redressal mechanism so that complaints can be made. But beyond this, there is nothing. So, for example, there's no reservation and there are no other requirements. Of course, reasonable accommodation is a broad general category, but, you know, there is no mandatory requirement. And we have often found that there are subtle ways of discrimination that people with disabilities face very, very rampantly in the private sector. So, for example, we find that a lot of now IT companies and larger companies are wanting to be very inclusive, and they make equal opportunity policies and they do hire people with disabilities. But after they hire, when they start working, the task force and their employees and staff have no training or familiarity or exposure to disability rights issues. So then what happens is you will take in somebody and nobody is trained or exposed to disability rights issues, and so then that person actually starts facing a lot of discrimination in their daily work. So for example, we had, you know, there was one case where this person was working in a very, very high, very, very well-known multinational corporation. They had set up a grievance redressal, they had set up a, you know, a equal opportunity policy. This person had low vision, and this person used to wear glasses, you know, to work, and was not able to actually sit for very, very long hours on the computer because of the fact that it affected his eyes. And after he joined work, his team, his entire team started actually making a lot of derogatory comments on his glasses, on his eyes, the fact that they would keep asking him to remove his glasses, you know, his dark glasses, and he would refuse because, you know, one of his eye was had stitches, and they started making fun of it. And finally, he said, I will work from home. I don't want to come to the office and work. And ultimately, it got so much that he actually resigned but then he filed a complaint. So, you know, these are minor, but there are very, very serious forms of discrimination and harassment that employees end up facing from other colleagues and co-workers and supervisors, because there is no, there is no training. You know, see, on when we talk about now the ICC and sexual harassment, there is a requirement of training. You know, the law only says that you have to train employees, but, you know, under the Disabilities Act, there is no requirement of training. So how will people who still think about disability from a very, very charity mindset, how will they be able to understand that disability is a rights issue and it's a human rights issue, and unless they're trained on it? So we find that happening very rampantly in the private sector as well. And unfortunately, there is no redressal. I mean, if they have a grievance redressal mechanism, that's great. But how do you go to court? There is no option. You can't go to court. And so if they throw you out, or if you yourself are forced to resign, then, you don't have any remedy against it. So these are some of the very serious concerns. I'd like to kind of end here. It's been almost half an hour. And maybe we'd like to take any responses or questions or any other remarks.
Thank you, Jaina. I think we have Saudamini. Saudamini, would you like to pose a question?
Yes, thanks for this opportunity. So first of all, I will talk about that person. His name is Devinder Yadav. He's also joined this, and then he's asking the questions, so I will go after him. So can you spotlight to Devinder?
Just a second.
So he's facing the problem since 5 years. I think
he can even write it in the chat. Does he prefer to write it in the chat?
Can you spotlight to Saudamini?
Can I ask a question?
Varsha, please spotlight to Saudamini. Yeah. So Devinder, what he was facing the problem, because he applied for UGC NET and also as a professor in some university, BHU University, he applied over there. And then he got his result with the 30% or 32% near around. He got a passing mark on this. And then there is a cutoff for person with disability. So he missed that, got then other people, like normal people, got their cutoff marking and all those things, but they all got selections as if he's missed to get that chance from there. As a being a disabled, other categories got selection, but being a deaf hearing impairment, he is still facing that issue and he is still waiting for that. Even also since 2020, he got again chance to in an entrance exam in the UGC, but still he is not get a selection over there. So he was just saying these things.
No, I just want to respond. See, there will be a specific reserved post for person who is hearing impaired as per the act. So, is it that?
So, Swadhamini is saying, can we spotlight to Devinder so that he can understand you are responding? Okay. Yes, yes, ma'am, please.
So, in the selections, there will be special posts, there will be specific posts reserved for hearing impaired persons in the roster. So, if that post is there, now if he didn't make the cutoff, were there other hearing impaired persons who scored higher than him? I'm just curious, who made it or nobody made it? Was that post filled by some other hearing impaired person?
So there was no hearing impairment persons. I was the person alone. And there is a one category, as I have seen on the chart, only HI category was there. After that, I didn't get the opportunity.
So hearing impairment category was there.
Yes, yes, yes.
And there was the cutoff mark. Did they give some concessions in the cutoff marks for persons with disabilities? Did they give some concession in the cutoff mark?
In 2020, I passed that exam, and I got to know that. When I have checked all the subjects and there is some particular percentage and that reserved for me, so I got that passing marks also. And I have seen some other categories people, they got less than to me and they selected for that post, particular post, and I didn't get the chance.
Oh, but then you have to challenge it. Let him contact a lawyer and I'm sure Rajiv ji can help and he should challenge it. If others have got it and lesser than him.
I have a question, ma'am.
So he has done this. He has passed this exam in 5 times in the same particular organization. Still, he is waiting for that opportunity. And he has seen other people are getting the opportunity. Apart from that, they are not getting the good mark as I got it.
Yeah, can I just come in here? Jana, this is Rajiv. Can I just butt
in? Yes, please.
So, Devinder's case has been sent to our lawyers in Allahabad. And we are examining the what is it that has really happened. What Devinder says is that somebody with lesser marks than him has got selected. So we are examining this and we will take it up in the High Court if we sort of are able to sort of pinpoint the discrimination.
Yeah, that's exactly what should be done.
Yeah, thank you.
Can I ask the question, ma'am?
Yes, please. Varsha, one of you can maybe moderate. I'm not able to see everyone.
We have Bulbul Gupta with us, I think, who wanted to ask a question.
I also want to ask the question, Varsha.
Yes, ma'am. I want to ask a question from ma'am that UPSC, which kind of laws are there for PWDs?
I'll just, I mean, there are no special laws for UPSC for PWDs. There would be reservation provided, and in the UPSC exam selections, there will be all the other requirements where accommodation is given, like additional time, scribe, etc. And then for the particular posts, there will be reservation of 4%, you know. Those are the requirements that are, those are the provisions that are there.
I want to know how much there's reservation for multi-disabled, because I am multi-disabled.
So that is 1% out of 4%. You know, that's 1% out of 4%. But you'll have to see, once you clear the UPSC, then the reservation for that category, which will be there, you know.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. I think someone else is wanted to ask a question.
Thank you so much. We have Bholi ji. Aap sawal puchna chahenge?
Yes. Can you spotlight him?
Yes, one second. बोली जी आपको अपना वीडियो ऑन करना पड़ेगा ताकि हम आपको स्पॉटलाइट में डाल सके. यस
So my name is Vijay Kumar.
Yeah.
Vijay Kumar Sahu. I'm from Lucknow, UP. So I'm working in defense sector as a UDC, upper division clerk. I'm working in the defense sector as a upper division clerk in office work. So earlier, in 2015, so I got an opportunity that gave there is some opportunity and there is some post, 19 post for the employment persons. And we got the notifications and there was no accessibility for us. And people were just speaking and saying, and we were saying, okay, we can do it work. And we have a doubt over there that okay, what is going on? As I can see here, okay, people are providing the interpreter in these sessions. So they were asking about person with disability certificate that has to be above 40%. Then I have seen I think so that vacancy is not true and people just taking out this, and I decided to complain about them. Because why this is a limited vacancies for hearing impairment only and there is no accessibility. So he's coming on the point. He's saying that there is a four people who were not using the sign language, and I totally doubt that they are not a deaf. They are hearing people, and they are just taking the benefit as a showing us that we are a hearing impairment, and they got a disability certificate from CMO. And I totally have a doubt that no, these people are not a deaf, because as I can see, whenever we are meeting the deaf people, there is some activity, and they do some communication with. And those four people were sitting quietly over there and going for selection processes. And I raised the voicemail over there, then ask them ki I need their details so that whether they are deaf or normal people, and I decided to complain about those people in the CMO. And when I raised these things in front of them and they were going for this, can go back? Just go back, yes. So I got it in the selection process. They were not using sign language. They were doing only voice. They were using the normal language. And we raised this issue, and still we are not getting any input for that. How those people get a job? Four people, though, were not hearing impairment, and they got a job. And what was the like selection process for them? How they get it? As I can see, they have only 40% disability certificate. As if being a deaf and hearing impairment, we have more than percentage of certificate, like for 70 and 80%. And for other hearing people are also were with me, and they did not get that opportunity. And I have seen that the hearing people, those were speaking, they got a opportunity from there. So what was the reason how people are getting this kind of certificates from CMOs and government departments? For the disability, I just want to say this thing. That's it.
Yeah, I can just respond quickly. Yeah, this we are seeing this where many people who either don't have a disability are, you know, sometimes are suspected of getting the reserve jobs, maybe because they have got some disability certificate made, fraudulently. We are seeing that. That's very difficult to prove. We have many cases like that, and they get the reservation and the jobs. But the issue of 40% and 70-80%, I don't think we can say that if someone has 40%, then that person should not get the job, and only someone with 70-80% should get. See, above 40%, everybody is treated equally. There is we cannot say that if I have a higher disability, I should be given preference. No. But I take his point that sometimes there are serious, concerns that people who don't have a disability have managed to get a certificate in some way, or who have less than 40% have got it and managed to get the reservations. That is happening in many cases, and that is a difficult issue to deal with. So that issue is there. Maybe we can just take one or two more questions. Varsha, would that be fine? Maybe just a couple of more questions.
Yes, I think we have two more questions. Just two more people who have raised their hands. So we'll quickly just take those questions and then we have Arun Kumar Singh ji who's raised his hand. Arun ji. अरुण जी क्या आप अपना सवाल पूछना चाहते हैं?
हेलो
जी अरुण जी.
हाँ, आवाज आ रही है?
बिल्कुल आ रही है.
सवाल तो बहुत सारे हैं, लेकिन मैं एक दो सवाल ही पूछूंगा, और एक सुझाव भी है कि कार्यक्रम बहुत अच्छा लगा. अगर ये हिंदी में भी एक बार आप लोग करते तो ज्यादा लोगों तक ये सारे जानकारियां पहुंच सकती थी, और हिंदी प्रदेश के क्षेत्रों के लोग ज्यादा इसमें जुड़ सकते थे. ये मेरा रिक्वेस्ट है, एक बार आप लोग हिंदी में भी इस तरह का आप करें. सवाल यह है कि 2015 में, मैं झारखंड से बोल रहा हूँ, 2015 में झारखंड में टीचर नियुक्ति हुई, उसमें डिसेबिलिटी कोटा में 27% और 35% डिसेबिलिटी वाले को भी जॉब दे दिया गया. जिसको लेकर मैंने हाई कोर्ट में एक रिट डाला है 2020 में, लेकिन अभी तक कुछ हुआ नहीं। सबसे बड़ा विचित्र स्थिति है कि 27% और 35% वाले को जॉब कैसे दे दिया। अरे दो जगह हमने इसको चेकलिस्ट किया है, और अगर ये देखा जाए तो झारखंड में इस तरह के बहुत सारे और मामले निकल के आ सकते हैं। तो ये सिर्फ एक टीचर नियुक्ति नहीं, मुझे डाउट है कि सारे नियुक्ति में कहीं ना कहीं विकलांग व्यक्तियों के साथ इस तरह का चीटिंग भी हो रहा है।
See, yes, this is an issue. It is very similar to what the previous person asked, that people under 40% are getting the job, even with 27% or 35%. And I think he has filed the case, and he'll have to await the outcome to see what can be done in that case.
Thank you, Jena. I think we'll take our last question. We have Javed Ahmed Taq from Kashmir. Javed ji, aap hain saath mein?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Jana Kothari, ma'am, very nice to see you, that you are mobilizing us and giving us a platform to talk about various issues of related to disability throughout our country. Actually, I'm from J&K, and we have a lot of issues here, like accessibility is one of the greatest issue. Indian accessibility campaign was launched by Prime Minister of India, and funds were released for this purpose, and even buildings were identified, access audit was done, but the accessibility has not yet been created in these buildings. This is the grave issue, and even the budget has come from Disability Affairs Division, and it is not utilized. So personal disabilities face a lot of issues. We have one grave issue for the deaf community, that we have a school here. It is known as Abhinandan Home, and it has been established in 1941. And a lot of children with disabilities who got the education from that school are the only surviving people who represent a deaf community. But after the conflict in the 1990s, the school became dysfunctional, and it is not being restored. It just needed some special educators, and it also needed some hostel facility for the girls, because a huge chunk of girls with disabilities who were earlier dropped out from schools, how they get the education up to primary level, but after that there are no social these resource teachers available. Hence, we have only one focal point, that is that deaf and mute school in Srinagar, that is not being restored. And if we can help this in this issue, around 100 to 200 girls and boys with hearing and speech disabilities will get the educational facilities. And there are a lot of issues, but important issue is that central government is not providing funds to implement the Disability Act that has been established in 2016. But for that implementation, if funds would have been mentioned in the every year budget, there would have been a lot of change at the grassroots level. But when there is no budget for this purpose, so the stakeholders don't talk about us. Hence, the disability sector is suffering a lot. We have educational issues. We don't have the proper infrastructure for the children with disabilities. We have the employment issues. A lot of people with disabilities, girls, boys, who undergo a lot of discrimination. Even they face humiliation while going to school. Some are carried in the labs with the only intention that you will get a qualification, and after that you will get developed and you will get the employment. But unfortunately, that then there is no employment. In J&K, we don't have the private sector. The private sector bodies are very less. Not so many good companies come here to provide jobs and do their work here. So we have got a big chunk of people who have livelihood issues. And after 40 years of age, we lose the parental support. Nobody is with us. We have a lot of women with disabilities who are now living life in isolation. That is a big issue with us. So when we do such workshops, we just get a vent and people get to know what is happening all around. That is a big achievement for us. What you can do, maybe you can do something for J&K also. Please do it. Please do it. Thank you.
Can I just come in here, Jaina, with your permission?
Sorry, yes, Rajiv, please.
So, Javed, you raised a lot of issues, starting from accessibility to education to employment, no schools. Please connect with Museb. We have been taking up your matters in Srinagar, and wherever possible, we will work with you. That offer is always there. We've been working with you over the last so many years. But if any specific question you have related to employment, please put that across. And one request to Jaina before she winds up, could you also touch upon the issue of horizontal reservation, because we feel that a lot of our people need some clarity on horizontal reservation.
Yes.
Thank you, Jaina.
Thank you. Now, I just want to add to Javed that, of course, HRLN and all your work is there. If you feel that anytime there is a need to just talk more about awareness on rights under the, you know, for persons with disabilities under the Act, specifically in J&K, we can do something together, I'm sure, for a larger conversation or discussion, because often J&K is always excluded, you know, and so I think, you know, glad you raised it. I'll just raise I'll just speak briefly about horizontal reservation. Horizontal reservation matlab reservation jo hai for persons with disabilities, which is interlocking among caste and other OBC categories. So jaise hum dusre reservations hain, SC, ST, OBC, वो उनको वर्टिकल रिजर्वेशन बोलते हैं. और कुछ कैटेगरीज ऐसे होती हैं लाइक फॉर विमेन, फॉर पर्सन्स विद डिसेबिलिटीज एंड सम अदर कैटेगरीज लाइक फ्रीडम फाइटर्स, वेटरन्स एक्सेट्रा, उनको हॉरिजॉन्टल बोलते हैं. तो ये हॉरिजॉन्टल रिजर्वेशन जो है वो सारे वर्टिकल रिजर्वेशन में फिट करते हैं. तो जनरल मेरिट, जनरल और SC, ST, OBC के सारे कैटेगरीज में हॉरिजॉन्टल रिजर्वेशन को फिट करते हैं. सो फॉर एग्जाम्पल, इफ यू आर अ पर्सन विद डिसेबिलिटी एंड देर इज 4% रिजर्वेशन, द वे द गवर्नमेंट इम्प्लीमेंट्स इट इज नॉट दैट दे विल गिव 4% ओवरऑल, दे विल गिव 4% एंड दे विल ब्रेक इट अप इनटू जनरल, SC, ST, OBC, एक्सेट्रा. सो इफ यू आर अ डिसेबल्ड पर्सन फ्रॉम SC कैटेगरी, you will come under both horizontal of disability and vertical of SC. So it is like an interlocking. SC, ST, OBC are all vertical reservation, and across them is the horizontal of women and person with disability. So that is how, and that is how the roster points are made. So sometimes in your recruitment, there may be only post for SC PWD. Then if you're not SC, then you may not get the chance, because that is how the roster is moving. So that is what is called as horizontal reservation. That is how they implement it in the government.
Ma'am, if we don't come under any other subcategory like the caste basis, SC, ST, OBC.
Then you become the general. Then you'll be under general.
That is the actual point, that we have to get 4 points of reservation from out of 100.
You will get 4 points, but not out of 100. You will get 4 points, but how the 4 points are divided, that is up to the government roster point, because some may be in the general, some may be in SC, ST. So the 100 point or 20 point roster, which is some states make 20 points, some states make 100 point. In that roster, they will give the category. PWD General, PWD SC, PWD OBC, like that. So that is how those 4% are divided.
This is also a complicated issue for us. And the second thing is that most of the times, they notify the fragment, they notify that posters in fragments. Only 10 posters are notified. Yes. Only 12 posts
are
notified.
And then only one post will be there. I know all these things happen, but unfortunately, that is how it is. You know?
Jenna, I have a question.
Yes.
You know, we had a case from Bihar where this person had applied. He was an SC and a person with disability. He was OBC and a person with disability, and he applied under the disability category. But when it came to his recruitment, they said that you are not an OBC, and he was certified OBC by the central list, but not by the state list. So that was a challenge. The other thing that I wanted to ask was that what if somebody is applying under the disability category and as an SCST, yes. What prevails?
No, both will prevail. Because SC, ST and disability, if you're SC and having a disability, both will prevail because they will then be getting the roster point for SC disabled. But that doesn't bar them from getting a roster point in general. So for example, like if you're a, say you're not a person with disability, you're SC category. You will apply, of course, apply in SC category, but you can also get in the general if you are selected. So the person with disability will apply, can apply as SC and person with disability because there are specific roster points for both. That is horizontal. SC disabled, SC PWD, you know?
Okay. So it will be under the disability category, the disability quota, or under the SC quota, or is it going to be both?
No, it will be under the both. It will be under the disability quota, but the disability and SC quota, they will interlink. So it will come under both.
Thank you.
It will come under both. Okay, I think I need to leave.
Yeah. So let's wrap up, Jenna. I know there are some other questions, but maybe we'll put them to you in an email later. We'll collect the questions and then maybe send it to you for your comments eventually. So thank you so much, Jenna, for joining us today. And I think it has been very, very informative for all of us. And we are at the end of today's lecture. And if anybody has any questions that was not addressed, please feel free to reach out to Rajiv sir or Joycey or me. And we can maybe take those questions separately or maybe put them to Jenna through an email and she can send a comment. Thank you so much for joining us today, Jenna. Thank you so much. Thank you, everybody. Have a good evening.
Thank you. Thank you. Bye.
Bye.